إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من بين خلقه وخليله، أرسله الله بالهدى والدين الحق فأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده، فصلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا، أما بعد، يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم، إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم، يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة أما أرضعت وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها وترى الناس السكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. أيها الأخ وأيتها الأخت، فما حالك حينما تحتضر وحينما يتوفاك ملك الموت ليأخذ روحك؟ لا إله إلا الله، إن للموت سكرات، كلمات قالها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في احتضاره صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه، كما روت ذلك لنا زوجته عائشة رضي الله عنها، المخرج عند البخاري في صحيحه في باب مرض النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، أنه قال: مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا، اللهم اغفر لي وارحمني، اللهم مع الرفيق الأعلى، الرفيق الأعلى، الرفيق الأعلى. هذه حالة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، خير خلق الله سبحانه وتعالى، والذي صدق فيه قول الله سبحانه وتعالى: كل شيء هالك إلا وجهه. فهو صلى الله عليه وسلم توفي في يوم الاثنين من 12 من شهر ربيع الأول، حينما تمت له 63 سنة. فإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. معاشر المؤمنين، فعلى أي حال نحن؟ وعلى أي حال سنحتضر؟ فإن كل منا على موعد باللقاء ربنا سبحانه وتعالى. فلماذا القتل والمكايد كيد الليل والنهار؟ يقتل بعضنا بعضا من أجل الدنيا، وحينما مسيرنا يكون إلى الآخرة يتوفانا الله سبحانه وتعالى ويسألنا فيما فعلنا في هذه الأيام. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: إن الدنيا حلوة خضرة، وإن الله مستخلفكم فيها فينظر كيف تعملون، فاتقوا الدنيا واتقوا النساء. حديث صحيح أخرجه الإمام مسلم في صحيحه. فمعاشر المؤمنين، لنتقي الدنيا ولنكون من الأكياس الذين عرفنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من هم حينما قال: أكثرهم أكثركم للموت ذكرى وأكثركم لما بعد الموت استعدادا أولئك الأكياس. حديث رواه الترمذي في جامعه. معاشر المؤمنين، هذه ذكرى من أول مقصر وأول من فتنته الدنيا. وإليكم معاشر المؤمنين لننتبه من حالنا، فإن هذه الدنيا إنما هي أيام. وما هو المهم هو هذه الأعمال التي ستبقى في حسابنا. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إذا مات ابن آدم انقطع من عمله إلا من ثلاث: علم ينتفع به، وولد صالح يدعو له، وصدقة جارية. معاشر المؤمنين، ثلاث وصايا التي عليها مدار الدين، كما أخبرنا بذلك علماءنا خلفا وسلفا. أول حديث أو أول هذه الأصول حديث: إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله، ومن كان هجرته للدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. والحديث الثاني: الحلال بين والحرام بين، وبينهما أمور مشتبهات، فمن اتقى الشبهات فقد استبرأ لدينه وعرضه. الحديث وثالث حديث، وهذا الأصل الأصيل، حديث عائشة رضي الله عنها حينما قالت: قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. معاشر المؤمنين، كلكم ذائق الموت، وإنما توفون أجوركم يوم القيامة. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم، ونفعني وإياكم بما فيه من الآيات والذكر الحكيم. قد قلت ما سمعتم، وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين، فاستغفروه وتوبوا إليه، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله على إحسانه، وشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا الداعي إلى رضوان. أما بعد، dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah admonished us with fearing Him. So therefore we admonish ourselves to fear Allah after singling Him out in worship, bearing witness that none deserves to be worshipped in truth except Him alone, and then bear witness that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and messenger. To proceed, Allah said in His book, O you mankind, fear your Lord, for indeed the earthquake of the day of judgment is indeed severe, the day in which you shall see every mother that bore a child shall drop that child, and that you shall see the breastfeeding mother being so concerned about her own welfare that she shall no longer care about the infant that she is feeding. And that you shall see mankind in a state of drunkenness, but rather they are not drunk, but rather the torment of that day is indeed severe. So therefore the question I pose to myself firstly, and I pose to you, dear brother and dear sister in Islam: what will your condition be on that day? And before that day, what will your condition be when the angels of death descend upon you to take your soul in order to transport you from this temporary life to the everlasting life of the hereafter? It has been recorded upon our very own Prophet and Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when Allah was taking His own soul, as His own wife Aisha radiallahu anha narrated for us, and as has been recorded by the Imams of the Sunnah, the likes of Bukhari and other than them, that when He came to the end of time, that all of us in one day shall have to meet sooner or later. It is a fact of life. What did He say? He said, La ilaha illallah, repeating those words, that there's none deserving of worship in truth except Allah. Repeating and reinforcing the very purpose of His creation and the creation of mankind and jinn. And then He said, indeed, death, the pangs of death and its pains are severe. And then He said, O Allah, gather me in the company of those upon whom you have bestowed your mercy, from those who are from the prophets and the messengers and the martyrs and the righteous people. For indeed, that's the company that I want to be in. So therefore he said, Allah, oh Allah, forgive me and have mercy upon me and include me in this company of righteous people. This was his last words. And then Allah took his soul. And the 12th day of Rabi al-Awwal, in the year of 11 of the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his life had reached an age of 63 years of age. So dear brother and dear sister in Islam, what is it that we are killing each other over in this temporary life? To the extent that you see the kings of this world and the different powers fighting over something that is going to end and finish one day. And indeed we are going to stand before our Lord and answer for our actions, for what we have done in this world. So what is this killing over? This killing over power, over wealth, the plots and the treachery and the acts of betrayal. What is it over? Something that isn't worth to Allah the wing of a fly. And then one day you're going to stand up to answer for those questions. Have you heard, their brother or their sister in Islam, the long hadith of the hadith of Sur, the hadith of the blowing of the trumpet? A long hadith well known by the scholars of Islam. And they have stated that indeed the chains of narration of this hadith are what they call muttarab. Muttarib rather. That some of them, most of them are weak. But in some of the narrations, there are things for us to perhaps learn from. For indeed, even though it pertains to a matter of the unseen, the ghaib, and that we should not speak about the ghaib without knowledge, but however, for the sake of learning and for the sake of stopping, in order for us to admonish ourselves, we mention a few points of this hadith. When Allah gave the trumpet, the horn, to the angel Israfil, and then he shall blow this trumpet, and all the souls that were living on the earth on that day shall be taken, and everyone shall perish on that day. As Allah said in the Quran, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, that everyone on the face of this earth shall perish, and only in the face of your Lord, the owner of might and honor, shall remain. So then, the angel Israfil goes and reports to his Lord, even though his Lord is most knowing of what has happened. So Allah asks him, even though he knows what has happened, he asks him, who remains? And he said, it only remains the Hamalatul Arsh, those angels that are bearing, that are carrying the throne of Ar-Rahman, and Jibreel, and Mikael, and myself. And that Allah says to him, indeed, take the life and the souls of Jibreel and Mikael and the bearers of the throne. And he does that. And then he comes back to his Lord, and his Lord asks him, who remains? Even though he knows best who remains, he says, only me and you, the one that lives and never dies. And then Allah says, indeed, I have created you for this purpose, and I command that you die. And then he dies, and only Allah remains. And then Allah asks that question, addressing it to the kings of the earth, those who had killed and vied for power and positions and authority, and who had engaged in acts of treachery and betrayal, and who had killed each other, despite the warning of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that indeed this earth, الدنيا حلوة خضرة, it is indeed something sweet and it's green. But however, he said, fear it. For indeed Allah shall perhaps establish you on this earth so that he will see what you do. So Allah asks those people who are fighting for positions and power, people who have perhaps killed their own people and engaged in acts of treachery and murder and even genocide and civil war and strife over what? Something ephemeral and something temporary like power and glory and status and honor. He asked them, لِمَنْ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ? He asked them, to who does the kingdom and the dominion belong? And of course, there's no one to answer because they're all dead. And Allah responds to his own question. He says, لله الواحد القهار. Said to Allah, the One, the Mighty. What we learn from this, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is let us pay attention to ourselves and to our condition. What is it that's really important in what we are engaged with? Whether it be that our daily business and our affairs and how we conduct our lives. Are we making this dunya, this world, in all of its glory and its sweetness and honor and its greenness, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us, to be the most important thing, to the point that we are even letting down our own children, that we no longer have time to spend with our own families and children, because the dunya has taken our whole priority. To the fact that we are prepared to betray and plot and plan in order for us to just get one step over each other. What is the point of that? If one day we're going to stand in front of Ar-Rahman, Allah Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, and answer for all the actions that we were doing, and it's either eternal Jannah or the torment that He has prepared for those who were criminals and who had transgressed the boundaries and who had engaged in acts of criminality. So therefore, let us make, as the ulama have said, as-sa'idu man wu'idha bighayri, that the one that is fortunate is the one that learns the lesson from other people, from those kings of the world who, upon their deathbeds, they came to realize that it was worth nothing, and that which was most important was perhaps the thing that people take for granted, that you having the first of that, you having a good relationship between yourself and your Creator, that you worship none but Him alone, giving Him His rights, enjoining the good, forbidding the evil, and standing by His commandments and leaving His prohibitions. And then, of course, al-aqrab fal-aqrab, in terms of giving your kith and kin their rights, beginning with the people of your household, with your family, spending time with them, looking after them, and teaching them, and sharing the good things that you have with them, and in your community, having those positive relations, leaving a positive legacy for mankind. These are the things that matter, and these are the things that remain for us. These are the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall keep on giving us reward. As the hadith of the Messenger Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, indeed when a son of Adam passes away, then all of their actions are cut except for three things. The first is beneficial knowledge that people keep on benefiting from. That this individual, they left behind a legacy, an academic legacy of knowledge, of research, of findings that people kept on learning and benefiting from. The second is that they raised, what did they raise? Did they raise a group of, a company of children who only raised up to inherit the inheritance of their fathers? But no, righteous children who were raised with the morals and the etiquettes and the values of Islam. And so for that reason, they kept on making dua for their parents. And they kept on establishing their rights, visiting their family and engaging acts of worship, asking Allah to forgive their parents and to elevate their status in Jannah. And third is the continuous charity, the a kind of trust that you left behind, a kind of foundation that you had established, a kind of venture or enterprise that people kept on benefiting from. Indeed, this is what being intelligent is about. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded when he was asked, man al-kayyis, who is the one that's smart and that's intelligent? Because he said, the Muslim, al-mu'minu kayyis, the believer is smart and intelligent. He said, the intelligent one is the one that is the most remembering of death, and furthermore is the one that prepares for that which comes after death. Indeed, this is the smart ones. He said, these are the smart ones. The smart ones are not the ones that look to plot and plan, and that look to get one step ahead of their fellow brothers and sisters, that seem to purposefully trip up people and seem to gloat in their tripping up. But rather the smart ones are the ones that pay attention to this criteria, looking after their families, leaving behind a legacy of knowledge, of research, and leaving behind a legacy for mankind, and a continuous charity that the people benefit from, and the people who furthermore establish the rights of Allah and His servants. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, may Allah make us among those who realize that which is truly important, and not make us among those who, when the angel of death comes upon them, they are in a state of shock and misery because they are not prepared for that moment. And let us not be fooled by the greenness and the sweetness of this dunya, for indeed it is only temporary, it is only days. And as Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah said, Ya ibn Adam, innama anta ayyam, fa'idha dhahaba yawmun dhahaba ba'duk. Oh, you son of Adam, you are only days. So when a day goes, a part of you goes. So dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us not allow a day to go by, except that we renew our intention.
And that we renew our repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we remind ourselves of those foundations that Islam was based upon. The first, sincerity of intention for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in seeking Him and in aiding His religion. And second, ensuring that we establish the sunnah of the Messenger Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For as the hadith has come, anyone that does an action that is not in accordance with our affair, i.e. the sunnah, then it is rejected. And thirdly, keeping to the limits that Allah has put for us. For indeed the halal is clear and the haram is clear, but between them are issues which are doubtful. So the one that kept away from the doubtful matters, they have preserved and safeguarded their religions. And lastly, dear brothers and dear sisters in Islam, Allah has asked us to send prayers and salutation upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وارض اللهم عن الصحابة أجمعين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعنا معهم بمنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم من أرادنا وأراد الإسلام بسوء فاشغله بنفسه واجعل الدائرة عليه ورد كيده في نحره يا قوي يا عزيز اللهم آمنا في أوطاننا واصلح أئمتنا ولاة أمورنا اللهم آمنا في أوطاننا واصلح أئمتنا ولاة أمورنا اللهم اجعل علينا من خافك واتقاك واتبع سبيل رضاك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون أقيموا الصلاة